And we're back live on the Philippe Matthews Show, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. If this is your first time watching the show, welcome, welcome. If you are a regular, frequent flyer of the Philippe Matthews Show, welcome back. Two of my favorite people, two of my favorite topics. Richard Rothstein is with us and Dr. Jacqueline Battalora. As you know, Dr. Battalora is the author of Birth of a White Nation, The Invention of White People and Their Relevance Today. She is a professor of sociology at the Saint Xavier School in Chicago, my hometown. And she's a former Chicago police officer. Once again, I won't hold that against you, Doc. Welcome back.
Thank you so much. Great to be here.
Richard Rothstein is a research associate of the Economic Policy Institute and fellow at the Thurgood Marshall Institute of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, and of the Haas Institute at the University of California, Berkeley. He is back with us. He is vacationing in Cape Cod, so I really, really, really appreciate him being with me and taking this time out this morning. He's the author of The Color of Law, A Forgotten History of How Our Government Segregated America. Welcome back, Richard.
Thank you very much.
All right, Doc, let's start out with defining this thing called whiteness that you have been working on for quite some time. It's part of the work of your book, pivotal piece of your book. What is whiteness versus white people versus white supremacy? And then we'll bring in and blend in the color of law and how that comes into play.
Sure. Well, it was built on the in the 1680s, the last quarter of the 17th century, in law was asserted this brand new category of humanity called white people. And so who's white then? Well, we know that it was built upon the idea that the British had of themselves as white and Christian. You can't detangle Christianity from whiteness as it was originally constructed. But what's equally as important to note is that as a matter of US law, despite the fact that so many of our founding laws required that one be white, who is white has never been defined as a matter of law to this day. So that's an important piece. And so what did that mean? That meant that those who were deciding who's white were judges, right? Because it got fought out in courts of law. In fact, the terrific book, White by Law, written by Ian F. Haney Lopez, does a terrific job of exploring these legal battles around who is seen as white and who's excluded from whiteness as a matter of law in court. So when we talk about white people versus whiteness, of course, is intended to capture far more than those who find themselves labeled as white or who win their whiteness through a court battle, as it may be. So what is whiteness then? Whiteness is not only those who are labeled white, but it also includes the structures put in place based upon a framework of thinking, a concept of white, those seen as white, being superior. So we have founding law, like I already referenced, the naturalization law of 1790. It was, you know, the first law in this brand new republic called the United States of America that addressed naturalization, the process one must go through. If you're not born in a nation, to become a citizen is called naturalization. And they established as a matter of founding law that in order to naturalize a U.S. citizen, one had to be white. So that structure built into our law is also grabbed or figured in to this concept that we call whiteness. So it's meant to capture not only the people labeled as such, but structures put in place that presume white superiority and advantage white people, whether we ask for it or not, whether we wanted it or not. Truthfully, that doesn't matter. The fact of the matter is that those assumptions about who is a better group of people, who are the real Americans, which we are seeing play out this moment as we speak, are those who are white like the British.
Excellent. Okay, so this is institutionalized racism. This is where the concept comes from and the structures. And Oh gosh, I forgot how long ago it was, Richard, that I first read your paper that you wrote as a 40-page paper for, that you wrote for the EPI called The Making of Ferguson. That's how we came to meet each other, and come to find out that that was part of the research that you were doing for the book that now is out called The Color of Law. Pick up, if you could, or add to what Dr. Battalora just kind of gave us, because those laws that were put in place, that this is what you had to be, you had to be white in order to be a naturalized citizen, how that plays out in, the, as you would say, the non-de facto aspect of segregation and inherent bias, racism, and white supremacy in the laws that are the reason why we can't develop and have not developed black wealth to the degree that white America has been able to do so.
Well, I'm not sure I'm on the same page with you here. The 13th and 14th Amendments superseded those laws that Dr. Battalora was talking about. Under the 13th and 14th Amendments, African Americans who were enslaved prior to the adoption of those amendments were given full rights as American citizens. And it's the failure to enforce those amendments that we're suffering today. But had those amendments been enforced, we would not have the kind of segregated society with second-class citizenship for African Americans that we experience. So I understand that the culturally assumptions were created by those early laws that assume a superior status for whites, but we resolved those issues in the Civil War, or should have resolved them in the Civil War. And as a result of the adoption of the 13th and 14th Amendments, African Americans should be treated as equal citizens. And it's our failure, as I say, to enforce those amendments that lead us to the situation we have today.
So, Dr. Battalora, if you could, I guess, come in on that.
Well, it is true that as a matter of law, persons of African descent after those amendments were passed were, at least as a matter of law, included. But lots of other peoples who were considered not white but who were not African American continued to be excluded from naturalization until the whiteness requirement was removed in 1952. So that's another important piece. We can't just reduce this to the experience of those who get seen as white and those who get seen as African American. It's a much more complex landscape in terms of law and race in this nation.
So these naturalization laws did not come off the books until 1952, is that correct?
The whiteness requirement didn't come off until 1952, but there was, with the passage of the 13th and 14th Amendments, persons of African descent were able to become U.S. citizens. So there was a carve out. The amendments granted access, presumably granted citizenship, but we know that, of course, was not upheld, as Richard is saying. We've never enforced.
So let's talk about that. Why do you think the laws were not enforced? If they were federal laws, if these were government laws, why were they not enforced? What do you think would be behind that?
A pervasive culture of white supremacy.
Richard, your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that's true. They were not enforced for political reasons as well. As we all know, at the end of Ulysses Grant's administration, the Republican Party made a deal with Southern Democrats to cease enforcing the 13th and 14th Amendments on behalf of African Americans in return for the presidency, as they made a corrupt deal in which the Republicans were given the presidency with Southern support in return for withdrawing troops from the South that were protecting the rights of African Americans. So that's the proximate cause of the virtual reenslavement of African Americans at the end of Reconstruction. Certainly, there was a culture of white supremacy that permitted the Republican Party to make that deal. But had the election not been so close in 1872, we might have had a different result. The fact is that there was an election, a presidential election, that was thrown into the House of Representatives because nobody had a majority of the Electoral College. And so bargaining took place. And that bargain, as I said, was one that ceased federal enforcement of the Civil Rights Amendments to the Constitution in return for the presidency.
When did the during your research, when was the first law put in place that you discovered that blatantly segregated and basically went against the Constitution that segregated housing in America?
Segregated housing. Well, there were many laws. James Lowen, in his book called Sundown Towns, talked about many local ordinances and that enforced racial segregation in many cities across the country. But the federal government wasn't really involved in housing until the New Deal, until Franklin Roosevelt's administration. There was no civilian housing being built by the federal government before that. So the first federal activity to segregate housing took place in the 1930s on the New Deal. The first agency of the New Deal, the Public Works Administration, was the first agency ever to build civilian public housing in this country. It built it to create segregation in many communities that hadn't known segregation before. There were many urban areas in the country prior to the creation of segregation by the federal government that were integrated in the early and mid 20th century. You and I have talked before about some of this. The great novelist poet Langston Hughes wrote in his autobiography how he grew up in an integrated Cleveland neighborhood near downtown Cleveland. It was necessary to have integrated neighborhoods in every metropolitan area of the country simply because workers didn't have automobiles to get to work, so they had to live close enough to downtown areas where work was concentrated. If you had a factory district where African Americans and Polish immigrants and Irish immigrants and Jewish immigrants and Italian immigrants and rural migrants were all working, they all had to live in basically the same neighborhoods to be able to walk to work. Well, the Public Works Administration, this federal agency, demolished integrated housing in this Cleveland neighborhood called the Central Neighborhood to build segregated public housing projects, one for African Americans and one for whites, creating a pattern of segregation that hadn't previously existed. They did this throughout the country. I like to talk in my book about the self-satisfied areas like Cambridge, Massachusetts, or Berkeley, California. Cambridge, the area between MIT and Harvard, called the Central Square neighborhood, was a fully integrated neighborhood in the 1930s. So it was about half black and half white. Public Works Administration demolished housing in that neighborhood, in that integrated neighborhood, to build two separate projects, one for whites and one for African Americans, to create a pattern of segregation in the Boston metropolitan area. They built other segregated projects there as well, a pattern that otherwise might never have developed with the strength that it did. So this was really the first federal action to create segregated public housing. There were previously, in the early 20th century, with the growth of Jim Crow laws, there were some cities that had ordinances that attempted to segregate already integrated neighborhoods. Louisville, Kentucky, Baltimore, Maryland, St. Louis, Missouri, cities, many others like this, had ordinances that attempted to create segregation where it hadn't previously existed. These ordinances would have been completely unnecessary had there not previously been a pattern of integration. The Baltimore Ordinance, for example, prohibited African Americans or whites from moving on to a block where they weren't already a majority. That's clearly would have made no sense if there weren't integrated neighborhoods in Baltimore. Yeah. In Virginia, the Supreme Court, by the way, found those laws unconstitutional in 1917. not because the Supreme Court was interested in racial equality, but because it felt that the laws like that interfered with the property rights of homeowners to sell to whomever they wanted, irrespective of race. As I say, these laws implicitly accepted the notion that there was already a lot of integration in these cities. Richmond, Virginia tried to evade the Supreme Court ruling that prohibited these kinds of racial zoning ordinances by adopting an ordinance. The state of Virginia had a miscegenation law that prohibited African-Americans and whites from marrying. So the state of Richmond, Virginia passed an ordinance saying you couldn't move on to a block where you couldn't marry a majority of the people already living on that block, trying to evade the Supreme Court decision. So there were these kinds of laws. The federal government then adopted a program to try to convince, after racial zoning was abolished in the 1920s, the federal government adopted a program to try to convince cities across the country to adopt zoning ordinances that would segregate cities by economics, not by race. Effectively, the purpose of these was to prepare racial segregation by creating zones that apartments couldn't be placed in, or multifamily dwellings of any kind couldn't be placed in. So there were all these attempts to segregate on the part of government prior to the New Deal, but it only took effect really in the New Deal because it was then that the government first got involved in the housing market.
Dr. Battalora, can you see whiteness and the structures of institutionalized whiteness and supremacy in what Richard just shared with us?
Well, you know what? Absolutely. I mean, look, those New Deal policies were made, as I understand it, not because FDR wanted racial segregation, but the only way he could get many of his programs passed was he needed the Southern Democrats to support it in order for it to pass. And they wouldn't support it if this racial segregation wasn't part of the package. So that's my understanding of this. So if we look back at what are the structures that were put in, and truthfully, I think that you have to go back to the founding period of this country. From our founding, we have put structures in place that gave more power to slaveholding states. And so if we're continuing to see the assertion of that power that was given at the very beginning through such things as counting enslaved persons of African descent as 2/3 of a person for the purpose of allocating representation. And so we see throughout much of US history, and I believe it will be shown to have played a role in recent elections as well. It has to, right? Because we have put structures in place that have given greater power to these, from our founding moment, to these slaveholding states that has been retained through complex mechanisms. And so we saw that weight of power in the South play out in Franklin Delano Roosevelt's time period when he sought to pass these laws. And so I'm curious to hear Richard's perspective on that, the weight that was held by the Southern Democrats and their influence in shaping some of the contours of FDR's programs, specifically the contours that pushed them toward racial segregation.
Richard?
Well, I'm not really, that's a common historical interpretation and it's widely held. I'm not convinced of it. Certainly there were some laws that the New Deal passed, that Roosevelt passed, mm-hmm. that Southerners would not have supported if they did not exclude coverage for African Americans. So for example, the Social Security law or the Fair Labor Standards Law, the minimum wage law, would not have passed if Roosevelt had not agreed to exclude occupations in which African Americans predominated, like agriculture or
domestic
work. But the housing program was a bit different. The housing program, for example, the Public Works Administration that I was talking about, the Public Works Administration could have gotten away, in my judgment, with creating integrated projects in the North, so long as they created segregated projects in the South. After all, we had school segregation in the South, but Southern Democrats never objected to integrated schools in the North, so long as they could maintain control of the African-American population in their own states. The housing programs could have been operated in the same way. The government, even if you accept, and I do, that the Southern Democrats held sway over what happened in Southern states, you could have administered the Public Works Administration programs as well as other even more powerful programs, the Federal Housing Administration later on. You could have administered it in a way that integrated housing in the North and segregated in the South and gotten away with it.
So then is the, in light of the segregationist approach that was taken in housing, is that a matter in your research, is that a result of individuals who held power and had that perspective? I'm trying to understand.
Well, yes, why. I think that that we have to understand that the Roosevelt administration, the Democratic Party at that time, was a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant party with elite assumptions. Yes. You have to remember that the first non-white Anglo-Saxon Protestant to be elected president of the United States was John F. Kennedy in 1960, almost 30 years after this happened. In my book, The Color of Law, I tell the story of how as Jim Crow was being implemented in the country after the end of Reconstruction, at first, at the turn of the 20th century, the federal civil service was integrated. It was under the administrations of Republican presidents like William McKinley and Teddy Roosevelt and William Howard Taft, an integrated civil service developed. There were African Americans who in the federal civil service who supervised white employees, had risen high in the ranks. When Woodrow Wilson was elected president in 1912, following his election, Wilson, as you know, was a Southerner, even though he had moved to New Jersey before being elected president. He was an explicit open segregationist. His administration began to segregate the federal civil service. They put up curtains to separate the clerical offices, to separate black from white clerical workers for the first time. They fired African Americans who were in supervisory positions to ensure that no black person would ever supervise a white person in the federal civil service. They built separate washroom facilities for African Americans in basements. This was the Democratic administration of Woodrow Wilson. One of the largest departments of the federal government at that time was the Navy Department. Mm-hmm. The Assistant Secretary of Navy, who was responsible for implementing these programs, was Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Now, I'm not suggesting that in any way that Roosevelt would have done this on his own, that he approved of this program. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't, but he certainly didn't object. This was part of the cultural assumptions of the Democratic Party at that time. Roosevelt appointed later in his administration, Franklin Roosevelt appointed later in his administration to the Supreme Court, a militant Southern segregationist, James F. Burns. When Truman became president, he removed Burns from the court to give him various positions in the federal government, administrative positions. And after the end of the Truman administration, Burns became governor of South Carolina and the leader of the Southern resistance to the Brown versus Board of Education decision. But this was a Roosevelt appointment to the Supreme Court. If Truman had not offered Jimmy Burns other positions in the federal government to cause them to resign from the Supreme Court, we wouldn't have had a unanimous Brown versus Board of Education decision.
Right.
So you have to understand, it seems to me, that this was a culture of the Democratic Party at the time. It's not simply a bargain that was made by liberals in the North with conservatives, with segregationists in the South. Mm-hmm. Certainly Northerners were less militant in their support for segregation. And there were many elements of the Democratic Party at that time in the North that were opposed to segregation. So it wasn't a uniform, universal attachment. But it wasn't simply a Southern segregationist assumption.
What I am fascinated to hear Richard share with us, and I want you to chime in on this, Dr. Battalora, is the normalization of whiteness. We see that happening right now in America. That one would even fight and say, well, it wasn't really blatant racism or segregation, it was more political, but it's still under this umbrella of whiteness because it's become so normal and part of the fabric of all our DNA that we really don't question it. And then we use these words to try and say that, well, you know, we're not racist, this is more political, or we're not we don't blatantly dislike Mexicans, but we have to protect our borders. There's this language that is being used to normalize this whiteness. And I think for those who might be watching this or watching my show for the first time, that might come up across this video and don't know that you've been on my show probably 50 times or something like that, Dr. Battalora, let's set the tone of how these anti-miscegenation laws came to be back in 1681, prior to the Constitution being written, prior to the first meeting of Congress, and those three blatant laws that created that third class for African Americans, where we didn't have the right to vote or run for office, we could not own guns and gunpowder, and most importantly, with this new creation of humanity called white, we could not sue or take legal action against that new humanity, that new person.
Sure. Well, if you go back into the 1600s in British colonial North America, you'll find that there is no reference to a group of humanity called white people. It simply doesn't exist in law. And there is a very specific moment in time when that first occurs, and it first takes place, a reference to a group of people called white people, that is, first takes place in 1681, and it is in an amendment to a law of 1664 passed by lawmakers in Maryland. And so that first law of 1664 punished British and other freeborn women who married enslaved Negro men, to use the language of the law. Here was the punishment that was meted out. She was enslaved for the duration of her husband's life, and any children that they might have were enslaved into their 20s. So that law of 1664, the lawmakers expressed that the intent of the law was to prohibit these, quote, shameful matches. And however, what we know happened was quite the opposite. Instead of discouraging those marriages, despite that rather significant punishment that was imposed, they were in fact encouraged. And if you put yourself in the shoes of the large landholders, you can see why they were encouraged rather than discouraged, because as soon as one of these marriages take place, your property value just went up, right? So that's exactly what happened. The marriages were encouraged, and it's not until 1681 that lawmakers in Maryland address this problem. And this time they get it right. This time they impose punishments on anyone found to have encouraged the marriages and on the person who performed the marriage itself. And it is in this amendment that we see for the first time in law a reference to a group of anyone called white people. So now the prohibition refers to British and other white women. So the question becomes, of course, well, why white? Why here? And what is the significance of this body of law that we refer to as anti-miscegenation law? So we know that white people were You have to actually step back before we can move into this moment. We have to remember that prior to this moment, among the 99%, so we're excluding the elite, the large landholders and the lawmakers, we're talking about the 99%, and in particular, we're looking at the colonies of Virginia and Maryland, and specifically diving into the historical work of Edmund Morgan. And he reveals to us that whether a person was of African descent or British descent, they were treated the same if they were of the same class level, treated the same. So that those who worked on a plantation, on the same plantation, there was no hierarchy dependent upon whether one, or separation even, dependent upon whether one was from Africa or from England. The only separations on these plantations were along gender lines. And we know that free men of African descent had the same rights and privileges as free British men as a matter of law. They could run for public office, they could vote, they could marry a person of the opposite sex regardless of her ethnicity or nation of origin. And they could testify. And so these rights and privileges were shared among those who shared the same status. So when you take that norm, and now we're going to shift ourselves into this period in the 1780s, which follows a massive rebellion called Bacon's Rebellion in the colony of Virginia. It tied up the colony for well over a year. We know from the historical research of Theodore Allen that these communications between the legal oversight authority in London, who had legal oversight over the British colonies, we know that in their written communication with the lawmakers in Virginia, that Virginia responded to Bacon's, the period after Bacon's Rebellion. Most people in the North American British colonies were extremely upset and panicked and threatened following this rebellion. And everybody was concerned. The lawmakers in Virginia wrote to the Legal Oversight Authority in London and expressed that their response to this would be a divide and conquer strategy. And it's only after this expression that we see the invention of white people, the assertion of an entirely new group of humanity with a whole new label called white people. And the way in which this whole new category for a group of people was asserted in law was by completely dismantling this social structure that had existed prior. So that level, and look, we can't call it purely level. I have to be very careful with my language here, because persons of African descent came and were rendered enslaved. So that cannot be treated lightly. Whereas the vast majority of laborers from Europe and particularly from England came as indentured servants, which was, of course, was for a number of years, usually between 7 and 14 years. So that's a huge difference, and I don't need to miss that important. What we do know is that those who worked in the same for the same landholder, whether enslaved, indentured, and of European descent, were treated the same. There was no hierarchy. We also know that when a person of African descent was free, he faced the same rights and responsibilities as a matter of law. And so that social structure was completely dismantled through.
Okay, Doc, thank you. Okay, go ahead.
So the first bundle of laws that asserted white people and dismantled that social structure were the laws that you referenced. They worked to ensure that persons of African descent, white person, a law was passed to prohibit free men of African descent to be in possession of a gun or powder, and a number of other laws. And you can see how those laws completely dismantled this relatively level playing field that the masses. We can't pretend that the 1% didn't assert and hold tremendous power, because they did.
Richard, how
you're breaking up. I can't understand what you're saying.
I know I've got a slight echo there. How does the data and the history of what Dr. Battalora has just, how does that land, in the research that you have done up to this point?
Well, your question was a little bit garbled, but I think I understood it. If not, interrupt me and I'll repeat it. I think the history that Dr. Battalora is describing is very important, and we should know it. But I also think that we have to be careful not to draw the wrong conclusions from it. Nobody is responsible for the sins of their ancestors. Every one of us is an individual with an obligation as an individual to fulfill our obligations as American citizens. Every one of us has an obligation to remedy the violations of civil rights that our government has created. And it doesn't matter whether our ancestors were here 500 years ago or 400 years ago or 20 years ago. We all have that equal obligation, both black and white, to remedy constitutional violations of our government. So I don't in any way disagree with the history that has been described, and I understand. I agree that it's important to understand it, but I don't want to draw the wrong conclusion from it. I don't think that trying to make current white people feel guilty for the sins of their ancestors is either morally accurate or a productive way to move forward. Everybody has to take responsibility for remedying constitutional violations. I was once on a panel, and I've thought about this a lot, and it really framed the way I think of it. I was once on a panel with Sherrilyn Ifill, who's the director counsel, the president of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. And we were talking about the history of racial segregation, and we were talking about the remedies that need to be implemented to desegregate American society. And somebody got up and asked the question along the following lines. They said, well, my ancestors only came to this country 20 or 30 years ago. They weren't responsible for any of this stuff. Why should I have to pay to fix it? Meaning, why should I have to pay more taxes to remedy these historical inequities? And Sherrilyn Ifill looked this questioner in the eye, and she said to him, you eat hot dogs on the 4th of July, don't you? And what she meant was that when somebody becomes an American citizen today, they accept the privileges of American citizenship. They don't think that they don't have the privileges of American citizenship because their ancestors didn't sign the Declaration of Independence. And they also accept the responsibilities of American citizenship. And those responsibilities exist whether or not their ancestors participated in violating the Constitution in ways that require remedy. So, like I said, I understand the history that is being described. I think it's important to know it. But we shouldn't draw the conclusion that whites today are any more responsible for the sins of their ancestors than blacks are responsible for those sins. We're all in this together now. We're all Americans.
Let me push back on you for a moment, Richard. Yeah. What sins have we, in terms of African Americans, what sins have we done in terms of ancestral, because we were victimized from the moment that we got here? So
I agree. No, I said that whites are no more responsible for the sins of their ancestors than African Americans are responsible for those same sins of the white ancestors. Nobody today is responsible for
you. And what are your thoughts on that? Because we've had Dr. D'Angelo on, who just her book White Fragility is coming out on the 26th. We've done many shows on this. How does that land with you? White guilt responsible for ancestral
Well, I have a few things I want to say. I don't know. Y'all are going in and out. Yep. They're doing work on our lines outside. I can see them.
Okay.
Yeah, so I apologize. I think you're asking me to, so I only heard bits and pieces. I'm sorry, Richard, of your last comments. But I did want to respond.
Yep.
I wanted to say this. I know that many white people can hear this history and fall into white guilt. What I truly find extraordinary, though, and I do have to throw this out as a though, when I talk about the laws that we adopted in this country, really from feudal England, that established relationships between men and women, such that as soon as you say, I do, women under the law of coverture couldn't enter a contract, couldn't create her own will, didn't have a right to her own wages, that when I talk about that law and the impact for women and family relationships, has somebody accused me of promoting male guilt? You know what I mean? So I just find it so, I mean, it tells us something about us that when we share facts, historical facts, legal facts that reveal disparate treatment in law that have given and roadblocks for non-white people throughout this nation's history. But when we share those laws, it gets received as the promotion of white guilt. So I think we need to say that there is something happening inside of us. And I think Robin DiAngelo's work has hit it on the head. It is a manifestation of the structure of our society, i.e. what she names white fragility, right? This is an example of white fragility. So I just want to name that, but then I want to talk about it for one more second, if you'll allow me, Philippe.
Absolutely. You're breaking up a little bit, but go ahead. We can hear the main points. Now you're frozen.
I am on that path. So here's what I know, that if your viewers are experiencing a view of this information as tapping into or triggering white guilt, I would strongly encourage you to explore it, explore the fact that that's what's being triggered in you when it doesn't get triggered when we talk about other groups and other statuses historically. And secondarily, I would encourage those who feel that to choose empowerment. Don't choose, make a conscious choice to move away from those feelings of guilt and to allow this information to empower you.
Okay, I think you froze. But I think you.
But I think you.
In terms of looking at this from an empowerment, it's interesting that you say this, that when there's a conversation about any type of discrimination of law from any other issue, whether that's, you know, gender discrimination or work discrimination, whatever kind of, oh, that's just wrong. That's just, there is no such thing as, oh, I feel, you know, there's a guilt there. When it comes to race, and this is why we want to talk about whiteness today and the color of whiteness, that the behavior attitudinal aspect of whiteness is so deeply ingrained that there's a feeling, there's a discontent, and then there's some type of, well, that wasn't me. I just came here like Richard was, like you were saying, Richard. I just came 20 years ago, and I'm not responsible for my ancestors. However, anyone coming to this country who wants to naturalize or has been born into this country and naturalized. You have been naturalized, conditioned, proselytized under this thing called whiteness, and has morphed into these institutions that has given you the ability to write about the color of law and what these manifestations of whiteness look like. How does it land with you, Richard, that rather than feeling, and I'm not saying you per se, but perhaps, I don't know, feeling white guilt versus feeling white empowerment when you hear about the ancestral trauma that was created and imprinted on both blacks and whites and all people during that time as a result of the creation of whiteness?
Well, as I've said, I don't really think of it that way. Well, I've lost you. Do you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. You're a little garbled because Google is trying to figure out the audio.
Yeah, I don't really think of it in that way. As I said, every American citizen today has an obligation to remedy violations of civil rights that were unconstitutionally imposed by their government, by our government. Everyone has that responsibility. And that's where I think we need to start. We need to start by looking at what our responsibilities are, how we're going to create a kind of society that fulfills our self-image as a constitutional democracy of equals. And I don't think that African-Americans have that responsibility any less than whites, or that whites have that responsibility any less than African-Americans. We're all in this together now, and we've got to fix it. We got a big problem. We've got to fix it.
May I ask a question? Because I'd like to build off of some of Richard's operations. I found that material really important, and I believe it was in relation to, I mean, the example that you gave in terms of property value appreciation. You use that as a very sort of concrete economic way to calculate what a reparation might look like. And I'm really curious, is there a cause of action that can be brought into court at this point, or are we beyond statute of limitations? What are the possibilities there for that sort of reparation approach that you've seen?
Well, what we need are policies, remedies to the inequalities that were unconstitutionally created. I don't object to the term reparations, but reparations is a small part of it. There are many remedies that we need to implement that wouldn't cost any money at all. We shouldn't focus only on the money ones. There are some, of course, sure, that would cost something. We should, for example, as a matter of policy, subsidize the purchase of homes, of single-family homes in suburban communities for African-Americans for whom those homes would have been affordable when whites were subsidized to buy them, but for whom they're no longer affordable today. That would be a program that would cost a considerable amount of money. Perhaps you want to call those reparations. I don't disagree with that. But there are many, many policies that we should follow that don't even involve any money at all. For example, many suburbs today have zoning ordinances that prohibit the construction of townhouses or single-family homes on small lot sizes or low-level apartment buildings. And those zoning ordinances perpetuate racial segregation. We should consider those zoning ordinances, if not unconstitutional, completely against public policy, and we should prohibit them. We should require suburbs to repeal those zoning ordinances and all suburbs to permit the construction of housing that would help to integrate and diversify those suburbs. Those kinds of policies wouldn't cost anything at all. So I think we need a broad range of policies. Some of them would cost money, some of them wouldn't. With regard to your specific question, there's some litigation that could help. For example, we know that many of the programs, or the two programs that currently subsidize the housing of low income, particularly African Americans, reinforce segregation. There's a tax credit program that the Federal Treasury Department has that subsidizes developers of low income housing. And those developments are almost always, not always, but almost always placed in already low-income segregated neighborhoods that reinforces their segregation. There are possibilities for lawsuits that show that those kinds of policies reinforce segregation. They have a disparate impact on minorities and violate the Fair Housing Act, for example. So there are policies that could be remedied through litigation. But mostly we require congressional policy and local state government policy and even local policy itself to enact remedies. I'm not suggesting that the civil rights lawyers will become unemployed if we pursue this through the legislative process. They'll have plenty of work to do defending these policies once they're adopted. Yes. For example, if we adopted the kind of program I talked about that gave a subsidy to African Americans to purchase homes from which they were unconstitutionally excluded before, there would be people who would challenge it, just like there are people today who challenge affirmative action programs in colleges and universities. And the civil rights legal community has to defend those programs. But it can't really start, for the most part, with individual plaintiffs claiming that they require or are entitled to reparations.
All right, Richard, I have sneak in one other question for you. Do you have any, by chance,
can't
example?
Hear
I've lost her, yes.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Do you by chance have any model policies that folks could look at, perhaps through the Haas Institute or through the NAACP? For example, if people in a community wanted to work, to advocate for a housing on single family homes and diverted those funds to support persons of color who have historically been excluded, are there such model policies?
Well, I'm working on my next project.
Great, we need it.
Which will be what can we do about it?
Another first, ladies and gentlemen, exclusive right here.
and I hope, I promise it won't take me 10 years like the last project took me. But I mentioned a few of them. Yes, there are, we should demand at a local community zoning ordinances that permit diversity,
yes,
that permit inclusion. That would be one policy we could follow. At the state level, allocation of these low-income tax credits that I mentioned can be redefined so that there's a priority placed on giving these tax credits to developers who will place low and moderate income housing in, you know, what are commonly called high opportunity communities, middle class communities where there's access to jobs and transportation and schools with high achievement. That can be done at the local level. So far as subsidizing first-time homebuyers who are African Americans to move into suburbs that are otherwise unaffordable, I think that the funds that would be required for that would have to come from the federal government. It would have to be a congressional policy. But in principle, there's no reason why a state government couldn't do it. It's just I don't think that state budgets would allow for that to happen. The same thing is true, by the way, of the Section 8 voucher program, which is a program, a subsidy for low-income families, typically African-American and Latino. That program does not desegregate because most Section 8 voucher holders use them in already segregated neighborhoods because of the way the program is structured. We don't have time to go into the details now, but there are many ways in which that program could be reformed. And that would have to be at a local level and the state level to permit voucher holders to use those vouchers to move into high opportunity communities, into middle class communities, to help to desegregate them. So there's a wide range of public policies. I'll tell you my favorite one and the easiest one to implement, the place to start.
Yeah.
Every one of our high school textbooks today misteaches this history that I've been describing about how the government segregated America. If the next generation doesn't learn this history any better than ours have learned it, they'll be in as poor a position to remedy it as we've been. So one thing that everyone can do is to go to their local schools. Everybody has children and grandchildren and nieces and nephews who are attending schools. They know teachers and principals and school board members and in some cases superintendents, and should press to have this history taught accurately so that the next generation will understand its constitutional obligations and be prepared to move forward on some of these remedies. So those are a few of the things that we can do. As I say, I'm working hard on trying to develop a coherent presentation of them, and you'll be the first to know when it's ready.
That's great. I look forward to that. Well, you did a pretty damn good job just now. I just want to let you know. Dr. Battalora, closing thoughts on our conversation today. I think we did a lot.
Absolutely. You know what? I just want to, again, thank Richard Rothstein. I'm such a fan of his work. And I love that his work includes very practical, doable, local level as well as national policy work that we can all your listeners, me as a fellow participant, can take home and integrate in my own community. So I thank you. And Philippe, thank you so much for having us.
Absolutely. All right. So the book is The Color of Law, A Forgotten History of How Our Government Segregated America. The links to that book is below in the description. And of course, Birth of a White Nation, The Invention of White People and Its Relevance Today is also in the description. And under the immediate video is something that I think we really need to look at that Dr. Battalora has created called the Whiteness, 52 weeks, called a Whiteness Competency course, if you will. And it allows both European Americans and African Americans to be able to look at this thing called whiteness and be able to separate themselves from it and be able to see it and look at it and say, oh, that's what it is. And if you will, to decompress or decolonize ourselves from this thing called whiteness so that we can look at what Richard has done, take those ideas and implement them for the European American without a sense of guilt, but a sense of empowerment and a sense of just moral responsibility of and love for your fellow man. So I appreciate both of you, Richard Rothstein. You are a gem to take this time out on vacation in Cape Cod. Give love to your lovely wife for me. I appreciate you. Stick around with me in the green room as we sign off. Family, you know what to do. Go and like, go share, and go comment. Tell us what you thought about this conversation. We're going to have, obviously, many, many more to come. Thank you again, my esteemed panel.
Thank you.